Okay. So let's start by just finishing up with any questions we may have had from last time. Is there any questions on the syllabus? Any questions about the syllabus of the class that we can go over? Now, granted, a little bit of the, since this is only the second time the course is being taught, there will be a few. We will be doing a little bit of playing things by ear as the course goes along. For example, one thing I'm going to do this semester is, since we have a relatively small class, I would like to have each one of you present a paper. I talked a little bit about this last week. So each one of you will be presenting a paper on a topic of your interest within the microfluidics field. For example, if you're interested in environmental monitoring, you might present a review paper on different microfluidic devices for environmental monitoring. If someone is interested in high throughput analytic devices, then you can present a review paper on single cell analytics and microfluidic devices. This will be sort of a segue into your projects, because if there's a certain area that you want to do your project in, then the first thing you want to do is learn a little bit about the area, right? And there's no better way to learn about an area than to look at, read a few review papers on the topic and then present it to the class. Okay, it's a good opportunity for you also to kind of get some experience in presenting a paper, presenting to the class. Yes.
You had talked about the proposal being not necessarily having to be fully on MEMS microfluidics potentially, or did you not say that?
I want the proposals to be in the microfluidics or biomEMS area, basically the topics of this class.
Okay.
All right. So, just really quickly, just to make sure that we've covered everything here on the syllabus, did we go over the course calendar last time? We did. Okay. Good. So, just a little bit more about this final project and presentation. This is going to be 40% of the grade. And at the end of the term, students will submit an NSF-style research proposal on a topic of their choosing. The proposal should include an in-depth literature review of the topical area, a clear description of the innovative research objective being proposed, and a description of the research aims which will achieve the objective. So you're going to be doing a written proposal as well as an in-class presentation, which will be evaluated by myself and like all the other students. So we talked a lot about the peer review thing last time. I'll talk a little bit about more about the project right now. Both the written and oral presentations are going to be graded on this rubric. How innovative and original is the idea? So this is a very challenging part because you're going to be jumping into a field that you know very little about. Hopefully you'll become a lot more familiar with it by the end of the term. But in order to find an innovative and original idea, you really have to do a lot of work in the term project in terms of reading about like the similar technologies and coming up with an original idea. I don't expect you to come up with an idea that's going to, change the world in a day, right? I know that you're students in the class, but what I want you to do is exercise your creativity. That's part of the fun of being a graduate student and doing research. Be creative and come up with an interesting idea that's different than what is out there right now. And it can be in an idea of your choosing. Along with the challenging aspect of this is that you have to prove that your idea is a new idea. So you have to understand the field that you're talking about. For example, if you're trying to propose a new environmental monitoring device, you should have a good idea of other types of environmental monitoring devices out there. And that's why we're doing those presentations to kind of get you warmed up in a certain field. You're also going to be describing research aims. In other words, you're going to be saying, I'm going to develop, this is the first aspect of the device. We are going to design this module to accomplish this task. Then we're going to design this module to accomplish this task. So the work that you would describe, the bulk of the proposal, at least a third to a half of it is going to be about the actual aims. This is how I'm going to do my project in a step-by-step manner, and it should be detailed and feasible. Now, we'll look to see whether the proposal is technically sound, and you have to convince the other people in the class that your proposal is technically sound. Welcome. Is the proposal well organized, written, and easy to understand? That's self-explanatory. Was the oral presentation clear and well detailed? And were questions from the audience adequately answered? So the presentations, I haven't decided on the specific time yet. I'm guessing about 20-minute presentation and about 5 minutes of questions afterwards from the class. But I'll give you some more specifics on that as the term goes on. So the final project is about 40% of the final grade. 20% will be quizzes, assignments, and class presentations. The 30% exam last semester I gave, or last year rather, this class is offered once per year. Last year I gave just a take-home midterm. Okay, and then 10% is for class participation and attendance. So I expect you to come to class. This is going to be a class where we do a lot of discussions. I want a lot of questions. We're going to be moving through a lot of different topics in this course. I know that there's going to be a lot of questions and points of confusion, so I want you to have a conceptual understanding of things. And since it is an interdisciplinary class, I'm going to explain concepts in terms of physics. I'm going to explain it in terms of like a conceptual understanding. If you don't have a background in electrical engineering, if you're not a chemist, don't worry. We'll explain things from first principles so that you can understand. And you'll see that a lot of these different disciplines of engineering actually have a lot, are quite related to one another. And I remember when I was first learning a lot of MEMS-related, when I was taking my first MEMS-related classes, I was amazed at how many different disciplines, mechanical engineering, chemical engineering, thermal engineering, fluids, how many things are involved in the design and understanding of MEMS devices. At the beginning, it was a little bit intimidating, but later I found that this is actually really, it's really a lot of fun to learn. Like, if you've spent your entire career in just learning about circuits, learning about these different fields will actually be a lot of fun for you.
I'm not going to ask how are biomems and microfluidics related?
How are biomems and microfluidics related?
Why are they clubbed together in this class? And why are they...
Yeah, that's a very good question. I'll go over that actually in today's PowerPoint presentation. But the short answer to your question is biomems. The biomems stands for biomedical microelectromechanical systems. Okay, so microelectromechanical systems, microsystems that are used for a biomedical purpose. A lot of different types of biomedical analysis involves the analysis of biological samples, like blood, saliva, different types of liquids. So in addition to analyzing those liquids and having ways of detecting components within the liquids, we have to be able to handle the liquids also. So that's why we do spend a good chunk of this course studying the behavior of fluids through microscale devices. And that's the interdisciplinary aspect of this course. Okay, so here's the grading scale, cheating policy, Blackboard. These are all self-explanatory. Like I said, I will post the... I will post the syllabus after class today. Backing up here just to touch again on the course textbook, Albert Folk's book, Introduction to Biomems, is the one we're going to be primarily using. Other popular textbooks in this field, Ellis Meng has a great textbook called Biomedical Microsystems, and then two textbooks on general MEMS devices that you may find useful in other MEMS classes if you take Dr. Honor's Smart Sensors course, or if you take Professor Zhu's MEMS course, these two things may be useful as well. Stephen Centuria's Microsystems Design, and then Mark Madu's Micromachine Transducers Sourcebook. Online sources, of course, you can look at as necessary. There's more and more, you know, as this technology becomes more and more commercialized, there are more and more sources available online for this. Now, in addition to this, it's not mentioned in here. The other big resource for you is Google Scholar. How many of you have used Google Scholar before? Everyone? Okay. Or most of us. So Google Scholar is a way that you can search through articles. I can just pull up a quick example right now. Let's go to scholar.google.com. Now, the thing, how Google Scholar is different from traditional Google is that it only searches through academic and research publications. So if I type in microfluidics for single cell analysis, Google will give a result like this. Now, one of the very nice things that Google Scholar does is that it ranks the results by the number of citations. Okay, these are the number of papers that have cited this paper. Okay, if you have a paper that has 1,000 citations, that means thousand other papers have cited it. This is a very important paper in the field, right? So the nice thing that Google does is that it ranks the results according to citations. For example, this paper called Microfluidics for Single Cell Analysis was published in 2012, but already has 91 citations. Now, another one, Microfluidic Device for Single Cell Analysis, this was published in 2003. This has been cited by 400 papers. A lot of times we want to look at recent papers in the field, so we can click on something like this where he says, let's look at only the paper since 2014. And then we'll have this paper called Microfluidic for Single Cell Genetic Analysis. Another thing we can do is, let's say this is a very seminal paper in the field. We want to look at more recent articles that have cited this paper. All we do is we click on this link, and we can look at all the papers that have cited this paper. And so, you know, this means we'll find more recent papers. Okay, and here we find another article called Chemical Analysis of Single Cells, also with many citations. And this focuses on the chemical analysis. So by doing this type of browsing, you can find papers on really on any field, on any aspect of the topics that you're interested in. Now, if you're logging on from on campus, you'll notice that there was a link that said full text at Wayne State. If you do that, you can go and actually get the actual paper. Let me go back here. Let me just click on this link here. It brings me directly to the page on analytical chemistry where this paper can be found. Okay. Now, once you get here, you'll see that in most cases, if you're logging onto a paper, if you're logging on from on campus, you should be able to read the entire paper. Now, in this case, I don't think let's see if the full paper is available. Okay, it is. If the paper is not available, you can get it through interlibrary loan. So what you can do is every paper will have a digital object identifier. That you can find this right here. It has a funny number like that. You can copy and paste this. And you can go to library.wayne.edu and just look up the Wayne State Library. And click on this thing that says Interlibrary Loan. So if Wayne State does not subscribe to a particular journal, Wayne State will find that journal article for you and deliver it to you within 24 to 48 hours. So what you do is you click on this, it says log on to Interlibrary Loan. And you can just put in a new request for an article. You just put the title of the article here. You put the digital object identifier. You can put this under the ISBN number or this doc number, and they will be able to find the paper. Once you submit the request, within 24 hours, you'll get the paper. In most cases, the publications will just be available online, and you can just read the PDF like this. Okay. So as a graduate level class, you will be doing some reading of journal articles, in addition to, you know, a lot of the class will just be lectures, just me talking about the different technologies and we'll be discussing. So, okay then, let's talk about BioMEMS. All right. So this is first module, sort of an introduction of this introduction to the field of biomems. Just a few different. We'll talk about a few different examples just to see what the field is about. You know, to get an interest in the topic. So first of all, this is going to be a graduate course focusing on in vitro lab-on-a-chip technologies, microfluidics and their applications. It's going to be open to all graduate students, graduate engineering students and medical students, and also students from chemistry as well. And it's a complementary to a lot of the other MEMS and sensors courses in the ECE department and the BME department. So some related courses at Wayne State, if you're not aware of these, just so you know, BME 4410 is Introduction to Biomedical Instrumentation. So this course covers traditional biomedical instrumentation. So things like, you know, EKGs, ECGs, pulse oximeters, so some of the very basic things that are used in a doctor's office. So you go and you understand the design of these specific devices. You actually design the device yourself. You talk about filtering techniques. So this is an undergraduate level course that covers some of the basics of some very common types of biomedical sensors. And there's a follow-on course to that, a graduate level course called Biomedical Instrumentation. That's 6180, and that's cross-listed in ECE and BME. And this particular class talks about more in depth about the principles of different types of physiological measurements, again with sort of a focus on things like measuring heart rate and respiration and physiological parameters in the body, some limited amount of imaging technologies, and how you can design such instrumentation. So you know, things like having signal conditioning equipment, amplifiers, recorders, and transducers. So as a graduate level course, there's this course also talks about more recent advances in the field there. Okay. And introduction to MEMS and NEMS. This is ECE 5575. Has anyone taken this course before? Introduction to MEMS? Okay. That is a course taught by Professor Yang Zhu. So this particular course is about microelectromechanical systems, just general types of microelectromechanical systems. This particular course focuses on, the class that we're in focuses on biomedical microelectromechanical systems. Okay. And then ECE 6570 and 7570 is smart sensor technology 1 and 2. This is a class that's taught by Dr. Honor. And it focuses on different types of sensing technologies. And I guess some of you have taken, one of you have taken Dr. Honor's Smart Sensors course. It's a good course, right? So in this course, you actually, it's a two-semester course. You design and test actually a smart sensor device. So any questions about these related courses? If you want to know more about these courses, do let me know. So in this course, we're going to be talking about, this is just a tentative course outline. Now we're going to start with the introduction section. Today we're just going to talk about just various types of BioMEMS devices and how they're used now, what the impact is. Starting next week, we'll talk about miniaturization and scaling. So I mentioned this a little bit last class period, when you take a physical phenomena, when you scale down a system from a very large size, let's say the size of a planet, and then you go down to the microscale, the physics changes dramatically. And the example of that I gave last class period was at the large scale, things have a lot of mass. So one physical phenomena that is related to mass is gravity. Right, so planets have a lot of gravity, black holes, stars have a lot of gravity. So those types of phenomena become more significant at large length scales. As you go to smaller length scales, mass goes down dramatically because mass is a function of length cubed. So mass-related phenomena goes down dramatically. Things that are proportional to length squared, phenomena that are proportional to surface area rather than volume, those start to become more significant than the phenomena that are related as L cubed. We'll go into more details of this in the class. So things that phenomena that are proportional to area. Can anyone think of a phenomena that physical phenomena that have to do with area? I don't know if we mentioned one in class last time. Surface tension is a surface phenomenon, that, and as it turns out, that actually scales as L instead of length squared.
Stress.
But yes, stress. Yeah, stress is something that becomes more. It's a surface-based phenomenon. Stress and friction.
Friction.
Right. So it turns out that friction becomes very important at the microscale. Okay. Devices that friction and a phenomena called stiction turns out to be a limiting factor in some types of microscale devices. Sometimes surface area can actually help you. Heat flux is a function of surface area. So the fact that you have surface area is much more significant to the mass of an object means that objects will actually heat up very quickly and cool down very quickly at the microscale, compared to larger length scales. So physics changes at the microlength scale. So our first lecture will be on miniaturization scaling and how physics changes as we go to the microscale. Today's lecture is going to be on some of the benefits of BioMEMS, why we want to, what are the particular applications of such devices, why we might want to use them. And some examples of lab-on-a-chip technology we'll also discuss today. The next section is microfabrication. So we're going to make a BioMEMS device, a biomicrosystem, and so we have to know what the fabrication techniques are. So in general, there's different types of ways that you can fabricate a device depending on what type of material you're going to make the device out of. Many of the previous generation of microfluidic devices, the early generations, were made of hard materials like silicon and glass. These materials were used because the techniques used to fabricate them were widely available. They derived from the semiconductor industry. So the same technologies that were used to make microprocessors and microchips and transistors were adapted to make devices that have small channels and small moving parts. And so those fabrication techniques typically were used on materials like silicon and glass. So some of the early BioMEMS devices were made from silicon and glass. And even today, these types of materials are also used because they have some favorable properties. Glass, for example, is optically transparent. It's chemically, it's not completely inert, but it's inert to a lot of the chemistries that are used in lab-on-a-chip systems. It has a very nice property of having a negatively charged wall, which is great for doing things like capillary electrophoresis, which is a way of using electric fields to separate molecules. We'll be talking about that. Materials like silicon have, they're hard materials. They're easy to work with. They have a high amount of heat transfer. They have certain chemical structures that allow you to make that allow you to microfabricate on them quite easily, and they have favorable mechanical properties as well. So we'll talk about a few techniques used to machine silicon and glass. Yes? Question?
What about graphene and
graphene and what was the other one?
TMDCs,
molybdenum. Okay. We won't be talking about those materials too much in this class. The question was on graphene and molybdenum and disulfide. So some of these materials, which are often used in semiconductor devices and nanoscale devices, we won't be really focusing on those types of materials in this class. But Professor Mark Cheng teaches a nanoengineering course, which is also a relatively new course. He does talk about more fabrication techniques in that class, in addition to Professor Yang Xu's microfabrication course.
And why would those materials not be incorporated in this field?
The question is, why wouldn't those materials be incorporated in this field? In fact, graphene, there are a lot of interest in using graphene right now in biomedical devices. Yes?
I guess graphene is mostly used in lithium-based batteries as well.
Actually, graphene is being used in a whole bunch of different applications right now. It's a very interesting material. It's a carbon-based material.
Yeah.
Graphene was just like, you know, it was, I wouldn't say discovered, but it was first like tested properly in around 2009. And they won the Nobel Prize like just a couple years afterwards for their work on graphene. It's kind of unheard of that you can win a Nobel Prize that quickly. But graphene is a single layer of carbon atoms, and it has very interesting electrical properties. It's very high mobility, so it's quite conductive, and it's also optically transparent and flexible. So imagine having all the properties of a metal like that's it's very conductive. But it's also flexible and optically transparent. And not only that, but graphene being based on carbon is one of the most abundant elements on Earth. So there's a lot of interest in using those types of materials for BioMEMS. But getting back to this original question, what materials do you use in BioMEMS devices? Sometimes it's a little bit different than what you would use in a traditional, like a computer microprocessor type application. There are different types of applications where the sensor that you build is going to be used for years and years. Right? In that case, you want the material to be made quite rugged. It's okay if it costs a little bit more money to make the sensor. With BioMEMS devices, a lot of times what happens, particularly when you're doing diagnostics, like medical diagnostics, the device needs to be disposable. So you need to be able to make the device out of a material that's relatively cheap and inexpensive. I think last time in class I mentioned that there's a lot of interest in paper microfluidic devices right now, things that are actually made from just, a nitrocellulose paper, which is extremely cheap. You can make a device for, in principle, one penny. The second aspect of microfabrication here, this soft lithography is going to talk about, we're going to talk about ways that you can mold. We'll talk about ways that you can use molding techniques to make microscale devices out of things like polymers, like this thing PDMS, and plastics, like soft materials like plastics, and similar materials. So you'll see that we're just going to cover a range of different fabrication techniques that you can use over a range of materials. And I would think that as a part of your final projects, you're going to also discuss how you're going to make the device that you propose. Another aspect of microfabrication specifically with biomedical MEMS devices is this idea of cell patterning. A lot of times in biomedical devices, we want to put cells and other living tissues inside the device. This is not true for all biomEMS devices, but a certain class of biomEMS devices is focused on understanding the behavior of cells and tissues. And there's also a field called tissue engineering where they use micro devices to grow certain types of tissue for re-implantation into the body. So in addition to having ways to create materials with silicon and glass and PDMS and plastics, we also have a way to pattern and make structures out of living cells and living tissues. So there's we can't use the same types of chemicals that we use to process silicon as we would use on cells and things like that, obviously. So there's a different set of techniques that are used for cell patterning. And some of the techniques which are used to pattern PDMS and plastics elastomers can also be used to pattern cells. We'll talk a little bit about that. Then, moving on after that, we'll start this unit on microfluidics. So that's unit 3. So we will be spending some time on this, and those of you who are coming from an electrical engineering background will learn about some behavior of fluids and physics and some fluid mechanics. As I mentioned, the reason why fluids are often used in BioMEMS devices is because we're analyzing some type of biomedical sample, or we're analyzing some type of environmental sample, which are in liquid form. So within the microfluidics unit, we'll talk about laminar flows and gradient generators. One of the nice things about microfluidics is that the fluids behave very, very predictably when they're at the small scale. You have this thing called laminar flow where you don't have turbulence, so you have very predictable flow properties. We can take advantage of that because fluids will mix in a very predictable way, and they mix by diffusion. And you can create some very nice devices that that can create chemical gradients and study the behavior of the biological cells and so on inside those types of devices. From a technology standpoint, if we want to be able to do these types of diagnostic devices, we also have to be able to mix fluids. We have to be able to control the flow of liquids from one place to another, and we have to be able to pump fluids from one place to another. So we'll talk about micromixers, microvalves, and pumps. Then we'll get into particle and cell sorting. As I mentioned in class last time, often we're trying to analyze some type of biological sample like blood. If we want to analyze blood, we have to first be able to separate out all the cells and the solid particulates from it and maybe do an analysis on just the serum sample. In other cases, we want to actually count the number of red blood cells we have, but not the number of white blood cells. So being able to sort different types of particles by size or by rigidity or by other properties is an important part of microfluidics. So we'll spend a little bit of time on that. Depending on how much time we have in the class, we'll talk a little bit about some emerging areas in the microfluidics field, like nanofluidics, which looks at the behavior of fluids in an even smaller dimension. Instead of the microscale dimensions, we'd be looking at the nanometer dimensions. And it turns out there's new physics there, too. The fluids behave very differently. You can create different types of fluid filters. You can create these things where charged particles will not go through, but only uncharged particles will go through. There's a lot of interesting physics that happen at that length scale. And it turns out a lot of those physics has to do with electric fields. So that's why actually a lot of folks in electrical engineering, a lot of researchers in electrical engineering are actually in this area of nanofluidics. Centrifugal fluidics and paper microfluidics are emerging platforms for microfluidics, which are used for point-of-care diagnostics, for portable devices, things that can be used out in the field. It can be devices can be very light, very lightweight. They don't require a lot of expensive instrumentation. And some of these devices can even be analyzed using your cell phone or smartphone. Then moving on, after we... there is one thing that I left out here. After the microfluidics unit, we're going to talk about detection. So handling the fluids is one aspect of a biomedical microsystem. Then another aspect is how can we detect molecules, detect cells, and so on. So we'll be talking just generally about the different types of detection mechanisms, whether they're optical, electrochemical, acoustic detection techniques. We'll touch on some of those. Now, Dr. Honor's Smart Sensors course, the entire course is basically on sensors. So there's a little bit of overlap with his course. But I feel like it's important to, you know, ideally I would just, I would say to take Dr. Honor's Smart Sensors course for understanding sensing techniques. But since it is a part of biomedical microsystems, I thought it'd be useful to have a little bit of that, enough of that content in there so you can understand the big picture of how these devices work. So module 4, biomedical diagnostics on chip, is where we'll start to talk about how the different modules within a microfluidic device. So, you have the fluid handling components, you have the detection components, you have the integration components. You can actually start putting together those different components into a working system. And so that's what this next unit will talk about. So the focus of this unit will actually be sort of a user-based perspective. we want to do this type of diagnostic assay.
How do we implement it
on a chip? So in this module, we're also going to be talking about, you'll learn a little bit about the different types of diagnostics that are done. So you'll learn a little bit about analytical chemistry. You'll learn a little bit about DNA and biology. You'll learn a little bit about proteins and so on. Just a little bit of biology so that you can understand what these devices are actually used for. A couple examples here. Capillary electrophoresis and PCR on a chip. Electrophoresis is used to separate nucleic acids. Those are the basic building blocks of life. It's the nucleic acids contain the genetic code for all living organisms. PCR is a way to amplify and detect genetic material. We'll talk about how that can be done on chip. We'll talk about cell culture and tissue engineering just a little bit. We won't be going too much into that. But how can you culture cells in a microfluidic chip? Traditionally, we culture cells. If you go into a biology lab, we culture cells on a petri dish, right? But if you culture cells inside a microfluidic device, there's a lot more you can do with it. You can actually analyze single cells, which is pretty interesting. How can we do cell sorting, counting, and isolation? Now, this has a lot of interesting applications because cell counting, you know, as a very simple example, if I go to a doctor's office and I want to get my red blood cell count. Okay, if I have a microfluidic device, I can do that. That would reduce the cost of the experiment. So cell counting is very important. In the developing world, we'll have a slide on that later today. Counting a certain type of cell, CD4 cells, is very important in AIDS diagnostics. And traditionally, cell counting is done using something called a flow cytometer. It fills up, you know, the traditional flow cytometers, the conventional ones. We have some here in our flow cytometry facility. It takes up about, you know, from the chalkboard to about this, to where Hamid is sitting over there. It takes up a large bench over there. There are folks in the microfluidics community who've made flow cytometers, which are just like handheld, really, really small devices, by taking advantage of microfluidic technology. You can use that for cell counting, whether it's blood cell counting, whether it's counting different types of particulates in cells in environmental samples, and so on. We'll touch on this topic of proteomics because it relates to separations on chip, molecular and chemical separations. The study of proteomics is the study of proteins. I guess if I could sum it up in a sentence without going into too many details, I will say that if DNA and nucleic acids are sort of like the blueprint of living organisms, it's sort of an instructions on how to build a cell. Cells are always reproducing, right? So the DNA contains instructions on how to build the next cell. So the DNA and genetic material is a blueprint. The actual materials that are made, so the analogy would be like the actual materials for building the next cell would be proteins. Okay, we're made up of proteins. And so proteomics is the study of proteins. We'll talk about how proteins are studied now using microfluidic devices. We'll touch on sequencing. Again, this is if we have time. Last semester, we didn't have time to go into DNA sequencing, but we'll try to this semester because this is very interesting. I think it's something that will be of interest to many of you. Does anyone know what DNA sequencing is? Could explain it? Okay. So it has to do with the genetic code that you have. So all of us have this, nucleic acids in our body, DNA, and the DNA contains a blueprint of who we are. Whether you have black eyes or blue eyes or red hair or green hair, what have you. So it used to be sequencing means that if we're reading your entire genetic code, my entire genetic code consists of 3 billion of these nucleotides. And if you can, it's a quaternary system, meaning there's 4 different nucleotides which are there, and there's 3 billion of them. Okay, reading that entire genetic code is gives a complete description of me as an individual. Sequencing is important because it's very important in the diagnostics of disease. For example, I could have a genetic disease. Many types of diseases are genetic. If I can have my entire genetic code blue, red, then it can identify where I have defects in my gene and which diseases I need to watch out for when as I get older. All right. In the future, it used to be that the first time a genome was sequenced, it took about 3 years, and I believe it cost more than $1 billion. This was just about less than 10 years ago. Now, the cost of sequencing someone's genome is less than $1,000, well, close to $1,000 right now. The future of medicine, everyone will have their genome sequenced when they're born. And the doctors will be able to tell you which diseases you're at risk for from the moment you're born. Some of this is already being done at hospitals right now. There's a whole field called genetic counseling that's emerged from that, where once you know your genome, how do you how can that information be used to advise patients on how they should live their life and so on. There's also the question of if you have a genetic disease, what's an example of what's the disease I'm thinking of? Priyan, can you help me out here? What's an example of a genetic disease that's late onset in life?
Huntington's
disease. That's the one I was looking for. All right. There are some types of genetic disease which may have which can be really, really bad, but it may affect you at some point in your 40s or 30s, at late onset, right? And there's also this question of, as a child, do you want to know that you have this gene, that you may have this horrible disease later on in life, or are you better off not knowing? So, anyway, there's a lot of interesting things that we have to face as a society. That I'm getting off topic here. The point I'm trying to make here is that sequencing technologies based on microfluidic devices is becoming... microfluidic devices is making sequencing technologies a lot cheaper. And because of that, it's actually going to completely change how we do medicine. And medicine is going to become a lot more personalized. One thing I want to add on here that we may have a little bit of time for is touching on wearable sensors. There's a very rapidly growing market now of sensors that can be worn on your body for tracking your health sort of more or less continuously. I'm seeing more and more devices in that. There's a lot of money going into that right now. That's also will be important. We'll touch on that today. Multiphase microfluidics, this is an area that my lab works in. So we will cover some of that in the microfluidics chapter. I'm actually not going to have a separate module on that. We'll probably just have one lecture, maybe half a lecture on multiphase microfluidics. It's an emerging area of microfluidics, important for high throughput studies. Any questions so far on course topics? All right. So the course resources, the textbook I mentioned, and notes and lectures are going to be posted online. Next is the... I mentioned about conference proceedings and journals. So we did the little thing on Google Scholar so that you can see how to look up papers on Wayne State's campus. If you are not on Wayne State's campus, you can use Wayne State VPN. Has anyone used VPN before? Okay. You can look up Wayne State VPN on Google, and they can help you set up a VPN connection so that even if you're off campus, you can still use Wayne State's resources. If you go to Google Scholar from off campus, you won't be able to actually access any of the journals because Wayne State pays a subscription for that. So you can only access them from on campus. But VPN allows you to operate your computer as if you are on campus. So different types of conference proceedings relevant to the field of microfluidics and biomedical devices, the micrototal analysis systems. Then we have the IEEE microelectromechanical systems. There's the IEEE engineering and medicine and biology. There are many other conferences. It's pretty rapidly growing field, so these are only two of the many conference proceedings that you can look at. There are journal articles as well. Lab on a Chip is a flagship journal for microfluidic devices. Biomicrofluidics and micro-nanofluidics also. Journals for chemical analysis, analytical chemistry is a very good journal for that. Electronic devices for analysis, biosensors and bioelectronics is another good journal here. But these lists are very, very short. Nowadays, I could list probably 20, 30 different journals that that will have the course content that we're talking about. So my recommendation is, if you're interested in learning about a topic, use Google Scholar. It ranks the papers by the number of citations. You'll get the highly cited articles. And most of the time, they'll be in reputable journals. Avoid articles from shady journals. because there are actually a lot of journals now that that publish articles without any peer review. You want to avoid those. There was one scientist got tired of these journals sending him requests to publish his article. There are some journals that now they solicit people, come and send articles to our journal, and they spam people with the emails. So this one researcher, he sent them a manuscript that said he wanted to see if they actually do peer review their papers. So he sent them back a manuscript that said the words, please get me off your blank mailing list. And you can fill in the blank there. And those words were repeated maybe 300 times. And it was a 10-page paper. And he even made charts and graphs that had the words, get me off your blank mailing list, kind of like arranged in different ways. And he had charts to show how angry he was, things like that. And they showed that he got an acceptance from that journal a few weeks later, saying that your journal has passed the peer review. It is a very highly ranked article, and we will publish your article. Oh, that's great. Yeah. So if you want to read about that, you can look it up on Google. Please get me off your blank mailing list, and the blank word starts with an F, so you can figure that out. Anyway, the point I'm trying to make here is there are a lot of there are many journals right now, but if you do Google Scholar searches, you'll end up getting articles that are quality articles. Okay. So moving on then. Now let's talk about what is BioMEMS. Introduce this field a little bit. BioMEMS stands for Biomedical Microelectromechanical Systems. So it's miniaturized systems for biology and medicine. So a few different examples of this: in vitro devices. So we call these in vitro devices lab-on-a-chip devices, which can do some type of biological analysis on chip. The term point-of-care diagnostics refers to diagnostics at the point of care. So instead of sending your sample over to a lab and waiting 48 hours for the results to come back, you have the device on site where you can do the analysis there. Examples of point-of-care diagnostic sensors: genetic sensors, sensors that involve chemical separations and detection, protein sensors, glucose sensors. A few different examples there. We'll talk a little bit more about those later. There are also high-throughput devices. So high-throughput devices are things like DNA detections devices and sequencers, DNA microarrays. So high-throughput devices means that where microfluidic devices are used to conduct hundreds or thousands of experiments in parallel. One of the advantages of miniaturization is that you can make many copies of the same experiment, or you can run many experiments in parallel, because each experiment doesn't require that many resources, because the experiment, you're consuming very little reagents and things like that. So You can do a lot of these types of high throughput studies, which is very important in the study of biology. Well, I'll give you a few examples of those. It's hard to describe just by these words here. We'll go into a few examples. Cell culture devices and cell sorting devices are also important part of lab on a chip. So a lot of devices, as I said, interact with cells. You can culture cells on chip. You can have devices that count cells and analyze cells and separate cells from other biological fluids. The cell cytometer, cell capture devices are within this category. There's also in vivo devices. In other words, in vivo means inside the body. In vitro means not inside the body. So in vivo devices generally implies implantable systems. So a popular area of biomems is neural implants, although we don't go details into the details of neural implants in this class. Cochlear implants and other types of biomedical device. Does anyone know what cochlear implants are used for? Yeah, it goes in the ear. That's right, for folks who are deaf. Certain types of deafness can be cured or alleviated using cochlear implants. Neural implants are for reading signals from the brain. Neural prostheses are devices that can actually stimulate areas of the brain. So it can also read from different parts of the brain. We don't go into too many details on the in vivo devices in this particular class, but a very interesting example of a neural prosthesis is where if someone has a severed spinal cord and they might be paralyzed from the waist down, folks have discovered that you can read the signals directly from the brain and use them to control like robotic arms and legs and things like that. So if someone is paralyzed, instead of being in a wheelchair where they would have to like move a joystick around to control their legs, you could potentially read the signals directly from the brain just by thinking they could move parts of a robot. So neural prosthesis refers to something called a brain-machine interface, where you're reading signals directly from the brain and using them to control some type of robot or other things. You can look up a video from the University of Pittsburgh where they trained a monkey to control a robotic arm, and they have electrodes implanted in its brain, and the monkey was trained to to move a robotic arm to grab a banana and eat it. It's really, really fascinating video. Stents. Cardiovascular stents, another example of a biomems device. Their stents are implanted inside arteries for folks with cardiovascular hardening of the arteries, cardiovascular disease. The stents can actually be functionalized with drug-eluting materials, so to prevent restenosis, and it can also be functionalized with other drugs as well. So that's an example of implantable devices. Glucose sensors, smart pills, physiological monitors, these are all different types of implantable devices. The smart pills thing is kind of interesting. There's a company from Korea that released something called the Smart Cam. It's a pill that you can swallow that has a battery in it and has a camera in it, and it also has a wireless link. So as this capsule travels through your body, it actually takes pictures of your intestines and stomach and transmits them wirelessly to an external camera. It's really neat. I'll see if we can find it here. And then you just excrete it out with the rest of your food. I don't think it can be recovered. I don't think it can. Yeah, it's actually better. It's actually better than a colonoscopy because a colonoscopy can only go so far up the intestines that this pill actually looks from your esophagus down into your stomach, duodenum, and small intestine, large intestine, everything. Actually, quite interesting. In fact, let's see if we can find that here.
seems less invasive on marijuana than they do in the medical system.
This is it. That's called the pill cam. And so the images are captured at 4 to 35 frames per second. It's displayed as a video, and you basically swallow it, and it takes pictures of your entire digestive tract. Very, very cool. Okay. So it's 5:30 right now. We actually have a lot of slides to go through with a lot of examples of BioMEMS devices. So why don't we take a short break, just short breather, like 5 minutes, and then we'll get into the main content of today's lecture in about five. All right. Thanks. All right, so let's continue here. Make sure that's recording. Okay. All right, so let's start talking about some examples of BioMEMS devices. And the way I'm going to frame this is just by talking about the benefits of BioMEMS devices. And in looking at some of the benefits, we'll also talk about some examples of devices. So again, BioMEMS means biomedical microelectromechanical system, devices that are small. So some of the benefits can be categorized into these three different areas. Now, one advantage is that the device is small, there are a few different kinds of benefits. First is that you can exploit the physics at the microscale that doesn't exist at larger scale devices. So you can sometimes exploit some of those physics for sorting cells, for taking advantage of things like laminar flows. We'll talk about a few examples there. Another advantage of having small devices is that the devices are on the same size scale as cells. So if you want to interact with cells, it's helpful if the devices that you're making interact are on the same size scale. Cells are about 10 to 12 microns in size. So you figure that if you took your hair and you took the diameter of your hair, that's about 100 micrometers. So a cell would be about, the size of a cell is about 10 times smaller than the diameter of your hair. So that gives you an idea of the size scale. With biomedical MEMS can be made around the same size scale, 10 microns, the typical dimensions. Actually, typical dimensions of MEMS devices are 1 to 100 micrometers. And when we talk about nanoscale devices, we talk about devices that are less than 1 micrometer. Okay. So you can interact with cells and other biological systems in interesting ways when you make devices small. Then there's the issue of portability. When you make a device very small, it becomes lighter, it consumes less power, typically, and so that makes things more portable. Devices that could, that may originally have taken up an entire room and required many hundreds of watts to operate could potentially become portable and run on a battery. And a lot of the low-cost diagnostic devices that are being developed right now interact with your smartphone. It actually uses your smartphone as a reader. So the things become much more portable. And in doing that, you have the whole idea of point-of-care devices. Another benefit of the small scale is that you reduce the cost of reagents. Reagents are basically like chemicals that are used in biological assays. For example, if you're trying to detect glucose, you need to add some type of reagent that helps you detect glucose in your blood. The cost of those reagents often exceeds the cost of the device itself. Okay. So the smaller you make your assay, the smaller the volume that your assay takes up, the less the assay is going to cost. So reducing the reagent cost is another important benefit of BioMEMS devices. There's also the high throughput benefit. When you have when you make small devices, you can make, instead of doing one biological test, you can do hundreds or thousands of them. And it turns out this is very important in the study of biology right now, the study of genomics and proteomics. A lot of these types of studies require high throughput experimentation, where you're conducting hundreds or thousands, tens of thousands of tests. So BioMEMS allows you to do that. It allows you to do complex fluidic control. If you look over here, you can see a device that has a whole bunch of different channels, and these little circles that you see in the middle here are little pumps and valves that can route fluids from one channel to another. That's pretty interesting. Are you having trouble seeing? Would it be helpful if we move this way? Okay. That's the easiest thing to do. Okay. Moving back to the high throughput benefit, this is an example of a device where, you know, you see each one of these green dots and red dots here. These are each individual cells. So you can do experiments where you're testing thousands of cells at a time in these really small devices with very small containers. And in doing so, you can actually look at the individual differences among cells, which is quite interesting. You can integrate multiple functions on a chip. We'll talk about that a little bit later. And then finally, there's a quantitative benefit. The quantitative benefit means that you can make devices with very well-controlled dimensions. Okay, so microfabrication techniques allows us to make microchannels and parts with very, very small tolerances on the dimensions, like plus or minus 1 micrometer, plus or minus 2 micrometers. So when we can make things to that level of precision, we also have very predictable device behavior because the dimensions have low tolerances. The device behavior also has low tolerances. For example, if we're flowing biological fluids through the device, the flow properties turn out to be very predictable because the size of the channel is very predictable. Also, because we're at the small scale, we don't have turbulence. We have these things called laminar flows, which also helps the flow properties become very predictable. So, as a result, our devices become more accurate or repeatable. You know, we have this thing called accuracy and... Okay. I'm forgetting now. Precision and accuracy, right? Accuracy is how close you are to the actual result, and precision is how repeatable your result is. Right? So it turns out you can have very precise measurements, you can have repeatable results with micro-scale devices because the device tolerances are quite small. They're not always completely accurate, but a lot of times they are repeatable. I mean, it really depends on the type of device. I don't want to make too many generalizations at this point, but just want to make this point here that there's a benefit, there's a quantitative benefit to these devices. And also, when you do large numbers of experiments, you can get statistical results. One example of this is something called digital PCR, where you're doing genetic tests, but you're doing like tens of thousands of them, and you statistically average or ensemble the results, and that allows you to actually count the number of DNA molecules. I'm not going to go into the details of that right now, but the point is that that's an example of an assay where you do many, many experiments and you statistically compile the results, and that actually gives you a more accurate reading than if you just did one single experiment. So if we start with the small-scale benefit here, you know, this first thing here, exploiting microscale physics. Okay. One of the things in microscale physics is that we have these things called laminar flows. A little bit of mechanical engineering for those of us who aren't mechanical engineers by training. let's watch this video on laminar flow. I think that's a good way to introduce the topic. So. Hopefully, internet is working.
Saving.
Oh, and we have to watch this ad. Great. There we go. So this is a video of laminar flow.
So what we're doing here is we're flowing one liquid through the channel, then we flow a second liquid through the channel, then we flow a third liquid through the channel. There's actually a junction on this end of the chip where there's different liquids coming in through the different inlets. Okay. The point is, you see how the multiple liquid streams, they flow parallel to one another without mixing and without turbulence. If you were to try to do the same experiment in a large pipe inside your house, there would be like sort of the folding of the fluid, they mix together. Okay. And so, yes?
Why does that happen at the microwave?
Why does it happen? Yes, so that's what this slide is about. Oops. So this happens because the inertial forces at the microscale become less significant than the viscous forces. Okay, this is an example of the scaling of physics. Inertia, okay, a packet of fluid, like a ball of fluid that's moving through a channel. It has a certain amount of mass, right? That mass is proportional to length cubed. Mass is proportional to length cubed. So the inertial force, the inertia of that thing moving through has an inertial force equals ma, right? And that, you know, Newton's laws, force equals mass times acceleration. So inertial forces has to do with mass that scales as length cubed. Viscous forces, you can think about viscous forces as friction, two surfaces moving up against each other. So that is a surface-based force. That scales as length squared, not length cubed. Okay, you remember how last time in class we talked about this? Notice that the at large length scales, the L cubed function grows more rapidly, and the L squared function grows a little bit slower. But at lower length scales, at small length scales, the L squared function actually has a higher value than the L cubed function. Right? So at smaller length scales, forces that are proportional to length squared, surface forces become more significant than inertial forces. Our surface forces become more significant than mass-based forces. In the case of fluid flow, we have this thing called the Reynolds number. Okay, the Reynolds number is just, it's a dimensionless number, meaning it doesn't have units, and it describes the inertial force on a small packet of fluid divided by the viscous force on that small packet of fluid. Okay, these dimensionless numbers makes it easy for electrical engineers to understand mechanical systems, because really it's a quite a simple calculation. We're not going to go and derive the Reynolds number right now, but the formula for it is rho times V times L divided by mu. And the value of the Reynolds number, you can interpret it this way. At high Reynolds number, you get turbulent flow because inertial forces are much more significant than viscous forces. The numerator is much greater than the denominator. At high Reynolds number, you end up with turbulent flow, unpredictable flows. At low Reynolds number, you get laminar flows, what we just saw in the video here. The Reynolds number is equal to rho times V times L over mu. Rho is the density of the fluid. V is the velocity of the fluid. So the V here, oops. Point this out here. There is this working? Ah. Stop that. There we go. That's what we want. This, the velocity, this is the V is the velocity of the fluid. The L is the length scale. This is the key dimension here. This is a physical dimension. All right? So as the length scale, the length scale is like the dimension of the channel. In the case of a circular channel, it's just the diameter of the channel. So if you have a very large diameter, the Reynolds number goes way up. Inertial forces become more significant than viscous forces, and you start to get turbulent flow. See, the Reynolds number actually depends on the velocity and the length scale. So when we go to smaller length scale, of course, L reduces, but also the velocity tends to go smaller too. When you have a small amount of fluid going through a very small device, you won't be going at very high speeds anymore either. So both of these terms actually become smaller. This term in the denominator is mu, is the viscosity of the liquid. Okay, we'll talk more about that later. Point is, when we go to low Reynolds number, in microfluidics devices, the Reynolds number is typically less than 1. Okay, if you look at this ratio here, inertial force over viscous force, less than 1 means the viscous force is more significant than the inertial force. All right, so who cares? So you can make parallel streams like that. Well, turns out, like, just taking advantage of this, you can do a lot of interesting things. This is one of the earlier papers that was published by Shu Takeyama's group, who's a professor at the University of Michigan, one of the pioneers in the microfluidics field. They showed that you can create a microchannel like this, where you have different chemical reagents flowing through there. This is an example of a protein that's been labeled, an unlabeled protein, another labeled protein, unlabeled protein, and so on. You can see that these streams flow parallel to one another. One of the things that you can do with this, we don't have a picture of this, but you can actually culture, you can actually put a cell in the middle of the channel here like this and treat different halves of the cell with different reagents. And one of the interesting things that I think a study by Rostem Ismagulov's group showed that if you have one half of the cell at a higher temperature than the other half of the cell, for example, if you're flowing hot water on one half of the channel and cold water on the other half of the channel, and the one cell has two different temperatures on it, then the cell actually, the growth rates of the cell is different on one side versus the other. Really unusual. So the point I'm trying to make here is that microfluidics, when these microscale devices can interact with cells in new and interesting ways, and that actually enables the biologist to do different types of studies that you couldn't do before. New science enabled by new instrumentation. Another example, something of more practical importance, microfluidic particle separators. Again, we'll go into more of the details right now, just to give you a taste of it. Particle separators are used to separate particles by size. Again, suppose we have a solution that contains different types of blood cells, and the blood cells can have different sizes. We want to separate out the different types of blood cells, cancerous ones from non-cancerous ones, red blood cells from white blood cells. We want to separate out the immune cells, which typically are larger than the non-immune cells. So this is one example. This is a pretty elegant example here. You flow in the liquid that has particles of different size on the left here, and then you have this pinched segment. Without going into the details of it right now, because we're going to talk about it later, what happens is that this pinched segment, the flow of fluid through this pinched segment in the laminar regime, again, we're depending on laminar flows. This causes the small particles to kind of go off in this direction, and it causes the larger particles to go off in a slightly different direction. And so at the outlet of the channel, if you had a bifurcation of the channel, you have different outlets going out here, then you can capture the different sized particles. Example of that is here. If you have one set of particles flowing at the top of the channel, another set of particles flowing at the bottom of the channel, then if you have a split in the channel like this, then you have one particle going in one way, one particle going out the other way. So these are called particle sorters. So you have, at the inlet, you put in your sample. So here, for example, you put in your sample, and then at the you can have multiple outlets, and each of the different outlets will collect particles of different sizes. Obviously, it has a lot of use in biomedical, biological samples, and also in environmental samples and so on. So these particle separators, they would not work at the macro scale. They would not work at large scale. They work on the basis of laminar flows, so you need to make the devices small. Okay, so a lot of these studies, you can see that these papers were all published in 2004, 2007, like all in the last 10 years. Okay, the field of microfluidics is actually relatively new. Why? Well, we weren't able to make the devices as small before. Fabrication technology, I'll give you a little bit of history. Like the fabrication technology has really come about in the 1980s and 1990s. The same time that microchips and microprocessors were really becoming popular and people were getting PCs in their homes, the technology used to fabricate microprocessors were becoming more mature, more accessible to the general public. And so researchers started using those techniques to fabricate other types of non-electronic devices, microfluidic devices and other types of micromechanical devices. Small devices, some with moving parts, some with non-moving parts. So the fabrication technology emerged in the 80s, 90s. And so starting in the 90s and the 2000s, researchers started to experiment with how can we take advantage of devices that have these small sizes and do interesting things with them. Okay, so these are all papers that were published just in, this was published in 2007, 2004. This is one of the earliest papers here on the left. Something called an H filter, where you can separate out molecules of different size by using just a simple structure like this, a structure that looks like an H that has two inlets on the left and then two outlets on the right. Some of the more, another interesting device is something called deterministic lateral displacement. This is where you actually have, instead of a channel, well, you said you have flow, but then you have all these pillars within the flow. You see all these rectangles here? So it turns out that if you have laminar flow and you have all these obstacles in there, it creates some interesting flow patterns, and particles, if you have particles inside them, again, we're not going to go into all the details of it right now, but the different sized particles will actually travel different trajectories. As you can see on this diagram on the right, this is an example of a deterministic lateral displacement device. You cannot see the pillars here, by the way, because this is a fluorescent image. So only the particles will show up. And what you can see here is that a particle that has a size of 0.4 micrometers kind of goes off in one direction, and the particle that has a size 1 micrometer goes off in this in a different direction. This has to do with the interaction of the particles with the flow as they go around these pillars, which are arranged in a staggered formation. Okay, so it goes to show that the fact that we can manufacture these very precise structures and the flow of the fluids around these structures can create some very interesting possibilities for sorting particles by size and even other properties as well. So moving on here, a little bit about the high throughput benefit. Again, one of the things about making devices small is that you can create, you can do hundreds or thousands or tens of thousands of different assays in parallel. So let's look at a few examples of that. A little bit of motivation first. In the drug discovery industry, there's something called high throughput screening. And in short, this is where a drug company says, okay, we have a million different compounds that our chemists have synthesized, okay, a million different potential drug compounds, and we want to test all million of those compounds on this particular cell. Okay, and we want to see how it changes the cell. Will it help the cell, if it's a cancer cell, will it help attack that cell without attacking other ones, for example? That's just a very general example, but you get the idea. Testing, this requires a lot of testing, right? And drug companies can spend hundreds of thousands of dollars, millions of dollars, doing these screening campaigns where they systematically test hundreds of thousands of different drug compounds against a particular biological target, like a cell or a tissue. Now, how it works is that, you know, you have plastic trays, and then you put the different drug compounds in the different wells of the plastic tray, and then you put your cells into each one of those wells, and you just and then you do something called a readout, where you design the chemistry in a way that if you get a positive result, then you'll get a fluorescent signal. The well will light up, and if you don't get a positive signal, then it won't. You go through thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of screening reactions to test different drug compounds. This is an example of something where it costs a lot of money because you just have to do so many of them. Now, this is what, if you go to a typical high throughput screening lab, this is what you'll have. Over here on the right, you have like the robotic automation. You have a big refrigeration unit where you store all the compounds. You have the liquid handling things, and then you have all these instruments that are used to do that fluorescent readout that I mentioned on the previous slide. And you have a lot of consumables as well. So it's very expensive to set up these types of labs, typically like in the millions of dollars. I think $2 million is actually a conservative estimate there. In addition, you have this high recurring costs. I'm not going to go too much into the details of this. I just want to get the main point across here is that the reagent cost turns out to be very expensive. You're doing a lot of different chemical tests and a lot of different chemical compounds. You have a lot of targets, so you have a lot of assays. If you have to do a million or so of these chemical screening assays, it becomes very expensive because you need to, for every assay, you need chemical reagents, and those reagents are expensive. So the problem is that it's expensive to obtain these reagents for these screening campaigns. So the solution is if you miniaturize the assay volumes, you can miniaturize the cost of the reagents. Or you can minimize reagent costs just by doing the tests in smaller volumes. So that's the motivation for a biomedical microsystem. You do tests in smaller chambers. If you can get the same kind of result by using less reagent, then you've saved a lot of money. And that's sort of one of the economic drivers behind biomedical MEMS. Yes?
At that scale, will those tests be valid?
Very good question. At that scale, will the tests be valid? There's two issues. One is the sensitivity. Sometimes when you're doing a test at a much smaller scale, it's more difficult to read out the result because there's less material to detect. For example, if you design a chemical assay to give off a light signal, or what's called fluorescence, it gives off light if it's a positive result. The amount of light that you get is obviously going to be a lot less if you have less material. So there's a sensitivity issue. Next, there's also the scale-up issue. The way that the assay behaves at a really small scale in a really tiny device may be different than when the device is when the same drug is tested again on a large population of cells. So you bring up a very good point, the scale-up issue is one of the known issues in high-throughput screening. That being said, a lot of the initial screening is done through millions of compounds, and at that stage, you only want to see if there's any type of interaction at all. If there is an interaction, then you can take those and then do a secondary assay where you're doing it at the larger scale. I put this up just as a basis of comparison. You know, some of you have seen this, Moore's Law in electronics. So it describes from 1971 to 2004, it describes the number of transistors on an integrated circuit. It's gone from 2,300 transistors in 1971 to more than 40 billion transistors in 2000, and it's well beyond that now. Why am I bringing this up? Well, transistors became smaller and smaller over time. If we look in the 1970s, the size of the one transistor was 10 micrometers, and in the 2000s, it's 0.18 microns, so 200 times smaller. And now it's about a factor of 10 or 20 even smaller than that. As we've gone from the 1970s to the 2000s, the transistors have become smaller and smaller. And because when you make a transistor smaller, actually they operate faster. Number one, and number two, you could put more transistors on a chip. Okay, and the more transistors you can put on a chip, the more complex computation you can do. Similarly, with microfluidics, there's a trend, the miniaturization trend. If we look at from the 1980s, 90s, and 2000s till now, we're trying to do more and more chemical assays on a given footprint. So because of that, the assay volumes have become much smaller, just like transistors have become much smaller. It's just an analogy, really. In the 1980s, you saw these 96-well plates. So a microplate is about this big. It's just a plastic tray that has a bunch of wells in it. That's where you do your biological or chemical assay. In the 1980s, there would be 96 of these little wells on a tray. And then in the 1990s, there are about 384. And then in the 2000s, there's like 1,500. And then nowadays, you can even see like these well plates, which have 3,000 different wells in it. The size of the plate remained the same. The size of the wells just became smaller and smaller. And the reason for that is because they're trying to conserve reagents. The reaction volumes that you see here on the y-axis, the reaction volumes, as you can see over time, the reaction volumes have become smaller and smaller, but the number of reactions per plate has kind of gone up over time. Right, so there's sort of a demand to do more reactions and with smaller reaction volumes. So this red demand curve that you see here has kind of gone like this over time. Now, once you get to 1,500 well plates and 3,456 well plates, it's difficult to miniaturize them further. Once you go below 1 microliter in reaction volume, you actually need to use microfluidic systems if you want to get volume smaller than that. So the microfluidic systems, one of the motivations behind them is that you can do these types of high throughput screening for drug discovery and life sciences research. You can do them in an economical way. I'll talk more about this later, but you talk about like if you do an assay in the microplate format, the sample volume is milliliters to microliters. And then if you do them in microchannels, you get a thousandfold reduction. And if you use a more recent version, if you use multi-phase microfluidics or droplet microfluidics, this is an area that my lab works in, you can get another thousandfold reduction. So comparing traditional microplates to droplet microfluidics, it's a millionfold reduction in the reagent consumption because your reaction volumes are that much smaller. So this is there really is an economic incentive to go to smaller and smaller volumes. And there's a scientific one as well, because when you do small volume assays, there's a lot of interesting biology you can do there as well. You can also do more very complex screening and complex chemical assays, because you can make these devices that have some very complex parts in it. This is an example of what's called microfluidic very large-scale integration. You can see this thing here. This sort of looks like a microchip, right? This is actually a microfluidic chip. Each one of these little dots you see here, this particular chip has more than 3,000 individual chambers. And the size of the chip is only about this big. You can see a picture of the chip on the left. This is a U.S. penny here, and this is the size of the chip. This particular chip has maybe a few hundred chambers, and then this chip over here has several thousand chambers. And this chip here is not much bigger. You can see the scale bar here is about 5 millimeters here. So this is an example of something where we want to do a very complex fluidic assay that requires multiple steps, mix this with this, add this one, do this one. and we need to be able to do screen over many, many thousands of different conditions. It's really impossible to do that in if you have a person like pipetting and mixing and doing those sorts of things. You really need an automated system to do that. And so these types of systems, they're called fluidic computers for a reason. You know, they have you have many chambers, and there are thousands of pumps and valves which can direct fluid into these chambers and remove fluids from them. Everything is computer controlled, so it's robust and accurate. It's called fluidic large-scale integration because you're integrating a lot of different fluidic components and chambers into a small area. This was pioneered by Stephen Quake's lab at Stanford University, and he's a bioengineer but also a biologist by training, and he's really done some amazing biology with these types of devices. They've actually commercialized the device. It's a company called Fluidyne. They're based in the Bay Area. They have a whole team of engineers working with them right now that develop these very complex BioMEMS devices, and they do some really amazing biology with them. A good chunk of which it's hard for me to understand, even being in the field pretty well. They do a lot of different types of genetic assays, single cell assays. And it's really enabled by the fact that you're able to do just such complex fluid handling that could not be done manually. So this is an example of microfluidics being used for high-throughput type assays, hundreds or thousands of experiments at once. Another example here, high-throughput single-cell studies. I touched on this point earlier. I think we'll end with this today. I just want to finish up this slide. We touched on this point earlier that in traditional biology, that we study a large population of cells in a Petri dish. Petri dish is about, you know, this big, and then if you remember from high school biology, you just put a population of cells on that Petri dish. And so on that dish, you'll have maybe millions of cells on there, okay? And when if you want to measure something in that dish, what you're measuring is the average response of all those cells. So, for example, if the cells are secreting something and you want to measure what the cells are secreting, you can't measure what a single cell is secreting. You're actually measuring what the entire population of cells are secreting, right? So that's traditional biology. Now, biologists are very interested in understanding the individual differences between cells. Even though we might have a million muscle cells plated on a dish, we assume they're all the same, but it turns out there are very slight differences between the cells. Okay, and this is something that was not known before. It's not that well understood, but individual differences among cells turns out is very important. For various types of diseases. In fact, like something like cancer, it comes from actually a single cell origin, where one cell has its cell cycle is kind of goes out of control, and so that one cell reproduces rapidly, and that's sort of the origin of where a tumor comes from. So there's a lot of interest in biologists to study individual single cells on their own without averaging their response over the entire population. So with using microfluidics, it's possible to trap individual cells in different containers and study each cell one at a time. And this is a picture I showed you a little bit earlier where you have these tiny, tiny chambers. And you can trap individual cells in those chambers. These green and red dots that you see here are actually individual cells. And they're each in an enclosed chamber. And the idea is that you could do studies on each one of those cells individually and then statistically accrue the differences between them. Okay. This particular assay, for example, was just a fluorescent assay. Depending on a green cell had a certain protein that was being expressed, a red cell had a different protein that was being expressed. They're two different cell types. In terms of the technology, you can make these biomedical devices that are single cell traps. You can create these very large arrays of traps where you can trap thousands or hundreds of thousands of cells at any given time. You can see that this is an example of a trap. That little circle above it is a cell trapped in there. And you can create these large-scale arrays where you can do single-cell studies. Another thing you can do is encapsulate cells inside droplets. So these are the things in blue that you see here. Those are water droplets, and what's flowing through the channel is oil. So there's kind of like an emulsion, water droplets in oil flowing through the channel. This graph on the right here kind of describes this idea that what happened here. This is a typical study where you have a bunch of cells in a petri dish, and you measure some type of output from the cell, and you get some type of intensity, which represents what the cells are secreting, for example. In single-cell analysis, you encapsulate each cell in an individual container, and you study the secretions of the cells or what have you in each one of the containers individually. So you're basically studying each cell one at a time, and you accrue like statistical information here, as you can see here. You accrue the statistics on the entire population, and you can understand the differences among individual cells. We'll go into more details on this later, but one of the very important things that it does, it allows you to study single-cell properties. It also allows you to discern individual differences among cells. So next time in class, we'll talk about some other types of biomems devices, like DNA sequencing devices, organs on chips, some of these wearable devices, which are really hot right now, like Fitbit and health monitoring watches, perspiration monitors, some biomedical sensors and devices for point-of-care diagnostics. I was hoping to cover all of them today, but we just looks like we're going a little bit slower. We'll pick it up next time in class. And so I will see you all next Monday. I'll post the notes for this module, and I'll also post the syllabus. I apologize for the delay in that. If you have any questions or concerns about the class, you know, you can come see me after class. And during the week, if you want to set up, if you want to come to office hours, besides the office hours that I've posted on the syllabus, which is 2:30 to 3:30 Tuesdays and Thursdays, if you need to come at a different time, to set up an appointment with me, and we can do that. Start thinking about your projects. Just wait till next week. Next week we'll cover some more of the areas of biomems, and that will hopefully give you more of a flavor for the different areas, and you can start thinking about your projects sort of at that point. Any questions before we dismiss for today? All right, great. So I'll see you all next week. Just a second here.